This is part 7 of the Iron Islands, but is also a standalone video about Harren the Black, the last Hoar King. Harren the Black of House Hoar, King of the Isles and the Rivers, came to the throne after his father, King Halic Hoar, died. Harren had one brother and was the grandson of Harwin Hardhan, a man that brought the Riverlands from the Neck to the Blackwater Rush under the dominion of the Ironborn, effectively increasing the Ironborn territory tenfold and finally making the Ironborn something to fear for the first time in centuries. Harren was much like his father and grandfather in that he infrequently visited the Iron Islands, instead choosing to live in the Riverlands to rule. He was also like his father and grandfather in that he ruled the Riverlands with a fairly bloody hand. However, Harren took his father and grandfather's brutality up a few notches. Harren the Black's cruelty was legendary throughout the Seven Kingdoms, and no one was more feared than him. This cruelty won him little love from his people, especially the Riverlands. Besides being a cruel ruler, there is one huge thing that stands out about his reign. When Harren came to the throne, his father and grandfather's seat in the Riverlands at Fair Market awaited him. But Harren decided that Fair Market wasn't a seat grand enough for his rule, and so he devoted most of his reign, almost 40 years, to building a magnificent castle beside the God's Eye, and he called it Harren Hall, because the guy was a serious narcissist. To build this massive castle, Harren plundered the Riverlands for materials and requested gold from small folk and lords alike. Harren even had weirwoods that had stood for thousands of years cut down for rafters and beams. His need for men to complete his castle, and very unsafe work conditions, resulted in the death of thousands of river folk who died in the quarries, chained to sledges, or laboring on the walls or five huge towers of Harren Hall. In the winter, the men would freeze, and in the summer, they would boil as they worked. This constant need for men and resources impoverished the Riverlands and drained the Iron Islands. But the construction of his grand seat was his obsession, and despite how it affected his people, he pushed forward to completing his masterpiece. And he let nothing get in his way. When infighting among Riverlords threatened to delay the building of Harren Hall, such as the fighting between the Brackens and Blackwoods, Harren would deal with it harshly, so his fortress would continue to be built. As the years rolled on, it would take almost 40 years to construct his new seat, the river folk lost the little love they had for the Ironborn since Harren's grandfather took over. Every year of Harren's cruel rule, their hatred for their king grew. Once Harren's castle came closer to completion, he began to focus on conquests. This did not make the Storm King Argilac happy. Argilac and Harren's family had a bit of history. Harren's grandsire, Harwin Hardhan, had taken the trident from Argilac's grandsire, Arik. As Argilac was an aged warrior by now, he didn't enjoy the thought of fighting the Ironborn and keeping them out of his land. So shortly after the completion of Harren Hall, Argilac decided to reach out to Aegon Targaryen on Dragonstone with an offer. In his proposal, the Storm King promised his daughter in marriage with all the lands east of the God's Eye from the Trident to the Blackwater Rush as her dowry. Aegon wasn't stupid and knew that those lands belonged to Harren, not the Storm King, and that the king was simply trying to put a buffer, the Targaryens, between him and Harren. So Aegon promptly turned him down, but gave him a counteroffer he didn't like, nor did he accept. Shortly after that rejected offer, Aegon sent letters to the Seven Kings of Westeros, the Citadel of Old Town, and both small and great lords, all carrying the same message. From this day forth, there would be but one king in Westeros. Those who bent the knee to Aegon of House Targaryen would keep their lands and titles. Those who took up arms against him would be thrown down, humbled, and destroyed. Then Aegon set sail for the shores of Westeros and came ashore at the mouth of the Blackwater Rush. Here's where not being very loved didn't help Harren out. The river mouth was undefended and the closest castles were held by lesser lords that had no love for Harren the Black. So when Aegon landed, they did little to resist him. When Aegon sent his sister wife Rhaenys to Rosby, one of Harren's territories, they also yielded without a fight. But one of Harren's lords did resist, and the first was Lord Darklyn of Duskendale. He joined up with Lord Mouton of Maidenpool and attempted to drive the invaders back to sea. When the lords of both castles were slain, Lord Darkland's son yielded up the castle and swore his swords to House Targaryen. So already in the beginning of Aegon's Landing, Harren is quickly losing territory, and he was not very happy about it. He called his bannermen and began to strategize how to stop this new invader. When Aegon began his march towards the God's Eye in Harrenhal, Harren put his plans into motion. Attempting to repel the Targaryens, he sent his men to fight on the southern shore of the God's Eye in the Battle of the Reeds, and he had his men attack Aegon twice, but was defeated both times by Aegon. Later, in the Wailing Willows, Aegon suffered heavy losses when two of King Harren's sons crossed the lake in longboats with muffled oars and attacked his rear. However, they didn't consider dragons, and on their way back across the lake to Harrenhal, Aegon took his dragon and burned Harren's longboats and his two sons. Harren, losing more and more territory along with two of his sons, called his bannermen to defend Harrenhal and keep him and his remaining sons safe. But the Riverlords weren't too keen on helping Harren. With how poor he and his father and grandfather had treated them, it was understandable that when Aegon the Conqueror came to Westeros and then the Riverlands, that some of the Riverfolk thought anything was better than the Ironborn. When Harren called his bannermen to defend Harrenhal, Lord Edmund Tully of Riverrun led the Riverlands in revolt. Lord Tully declared for House Targaryen and raised the dragon banner over his castle, and then rode with his knights and archers to join Aegon. Seeing Lord Edmund defy Harren gave hope to the other Riverlords, and soon, one by one, they also declared for the Targaryens and renounced Harren the Black. Shortly after that, Harrenhal was attacked by Malisters, Blackwoods, Brackens, Pipers, Freys, Strongs, and Vances. Seeing that he was outnumbered, Harren hid in his castle, barred his gates, and waited with the rest of his sons in what he considered an impregnable stronghold. Harrenhal boasted 5 huge towers, an inexhaustible source of fresh water, huge subterranean vaults stocked with provisions, and massive walls of black stone higher than any ladder that couldn't be broken by a ram or shattered by a trebuchet. So he was extremely confident that that would be enough to hold out against Aegon and his host. Once Aegon was outside the castle with the other Riverlords, he sent a maester to the gates to parley. Harren, though old and gray, still was a fierce warrior in his black armor, and came out to treat. Both Harren and Aegon had a maester and their banner bearer with them, so that their conversation was remembered. Aegon at first told him to yield, saying, "Yield now, and you may remain as Lord of the Iron Islands. Yield now, and your sons will live to rule after you. I have 8,000 men outside your walls." But Harren didn't think that was too impressive, responding, "What is outside my walls is of no concern to me. Those walls are strong and thick." Aegon countered, "But not so high as to keep out dragons. Dragons fly." Harren would not be swayed. "I built in stone. Stone does not burn." Aegon ended the conversation telling Harren, "When the sun sets, your line shall end." Harren simply spat at him and returned to his castle, where he sent every man of his to the parapets armed with spears, bows, and crossbows. He promised his men riches and lands to whichever of them could bring the dragon down. Taking it a step further, he proclaimed, "Had I a daughter, the dragon slayer would claim her hand as well. Instead, I will give him one of the Tully's daughters, or all 3 if he likes. Or he may pick one of the Blackwoods whelps, or Strongs, or any girl born of these traitors of the Trident, these lords of yellow mud." Figuring he had antagonized people enough for the day, he then retired to his tower, surrounded by his household guards, and had dinner with his remaining sons. But Harren made a huge mistake in discounting Aegon and his dragon. When night fell, Aegon took his dragon high up into the clouds. Then he descended towards the castle, and when the great towers were in sight, his dragon roared and bathed them in black fire with swirls of red. Harren was correct that stone doesn't burn, but it will melt and crack if hot enough. He also forgot that his castle wasn't completely made of stone. Hemp, straw, wool, wood, bread, salted beef, and grain all caught fire. Harren's men also caught fire. Screaming, the Iron Men were enveloped by flames as they ran across the yards and fell from the wall walks to die upon the ground. The men outside the castle reported that the towers of Harrenhal glowed red, like five great candles. And then, just like candles, they began to twist and melt, molten stone running down their sides. Harren met the same fate as his men. Him and his sons died in the fires that consumed his castle, and with them, House Hor died. The next day, Aegon I crowned Edmund Tully Lord of Riverrun, Lord Paramount of the Trident, and the Ironborn officially lost their hold on the Riverlands, something they managed to hold for a mere 3 generations, but still pretty impressive for the Ironborn. And quick side note, you might be wondering where Harren's brother I mentioned at the beginning was during all of this. Well, at the time of Aegon's conquest, Harren's brother had actually become the Lord Commander of the Night's Watch. Though the Seven Kingdoms were being attacked and he heard of his brother and nephews being slaughtered by the Targaryen warrior, he did not intervene with the war and kept his vows. So that was the end of House Hor and the Ironborn's control over the Riverlands. In part 8, I'll talk about the chaos on the Iron Islands following the death of Harren and his sons, and the Greyjoys taking over, and their rather choppy rule. Thank you for watching. Please give the video a thumbs up as it helps the video out a ton, and come back for more Game of Thrones, Star Wars, comics, and more.